Hi there. In this video, I'm going to do some work on this Sony Vaio multimedia computer from back in the day. So let's see what this thing has inside, because honestly, this thing is really big for a standard computer. So might have some interesting stuff occupying the interior of this thing. Yeah, and I forgot to tell you, I am going to attempt to upgrade the Pentium D. Yeah, it's a Pentium D CPU, so the first dual core from Intel, from 2.8 GHz that it has inside to, I think, 3 GHz, this one. Eh, it's a bump, what can I say? And this particular keyboard and mouse with the touch on it will be used for controlling this thing. Because it's multimedia, you probably will put it somewhere where you cannot reach it with a keyboard with a wire and mouse with a wire. Yes, you could use wireless, but this thing, you can take this in the bed and whatnot. So it's a bit more interesting. But yeah, let me find a way to open this thing up and see why this is not closing properly. Yeah. Sorry for the not so good video quality. I'm using the wide angle lens, and although my windows are fully open, it's a dark or cloudy day outside, so this is what my camera can do. And this thing has two fans in the back and a huge CPU cooler, because Pentium D's actually get quite hot. Here we have the infrared module. Here, honestly, I don't have a clue, but maybe, what is that? Could it be Bluetooth? Let me investigate, I'm curious. Okay, so searching for the code, it says it's a receiver for Sony multimedia computers. But somewhere in there, I see the telltale sign of a Bluetooth antenna. So I am expecting this to be some sort of receiver, if it's able to connect to a mobile phone, and you can send play music through this thing into your audio system. Yeah, that would be nice. And yeah, obviously it's put right here behind the plastic, because with the antenna in that direction, because you want it to actually get signal. If you put it behind metal, you lose all your signal. And it also has standard USB from what I see there possibility. So this thing can be used as a directly USB Bluetooth module if you solder wires to it. Maybe it even doesn't have all the components to use it like that. So yeah, let's take out this thing. It has a laptop CD-ROM drive, the type that and it's probably not working anymore. Pretend you haven't seen that. The type that actually out ejects the disk, which is the type that I always like. Always seemed interesting how they eject the disks instead of ejecting the door, the tray itself. Yeah, this will take a bit of time. Let's see if I can actually lift this thing up. I have no clue how this is done. Okay, it seems like this. And yeah, ooh, this is heavy. And this thing, look here. This has room for how many hard drives? Three hard drives, and we have 320 gig. What is that? Seagate already in, a Barracuda at 7200 RPM. Yeah, this is interesting. PSU, how powerful is it? Does it save 297 watts? Damn, they were really exact with that. So So about 300 watts, which is decent. Another cooler in there for something, presumably. I think there we have the card reader, don't we? Yeah, the card reader is in that area. So we are cooling the card reader, aren't we? And putting some fresh air inside this case. That I'm spinning all around and the side just fell off. Dex. Anyway. But the problem with this, when I bought it, it was listed as having a bad VGA card. And you can see it's a weird one. Look at all the connections in here. So it's a specialized card for this particular computer. And look at all these other cards in here. I think this is what is this? Ah, this is a TV Tuner. Yeah, back in the day, TV Tuner. Nice. And here we have all sorts of audio stuff and this is interesting. And as for video output digital one, we just have a single HDMI from what I see here. The rest are analogic. So yeah, let's baby girl in the background. Let's unplug this thing and take it out and see if I can see anything that doesn't seem to. Okay, that doesn't really want to pop out, does it? Never pull on the cables like I'm doing now. That this is not the proper way to remove things. I've been lucky and never ripped any cable, but it can always happen, so don't do what I do. Let's get this thing out quickly and don't lose the screw inside the computer. Does it have a locking mechanism on the other side? Okay, that's going to be hard to reach. Be back in a second. This thing also has a Wi-Fi card somewhere down on the motherboard under that. Yeah, and my little helper is here, putting her fingers everywhere. And for that Wi-Fi card, here is the output for the antenna. And I have an antenna that I took out from a bad router. It's a D-Link, which presumably has the same connector. And yes, it actually does have the same connector. So we have antenna for the Wi-Fi. Yeah. And for the GPU itself, I see absolutely nothing wrong on me. Sorry about that. Baby girl moving everything around. I see absolutely no... please close the drawer. No problem on the GPU itself, but I found a bad capacitor on the motherboard. So, yeah, thank you helping me. So probably that is actually causing the issue. Let me try and focus on it. Yeah, quite hard. Okay, so sorry for the quality. That one right in the middle is the only one that seems to be bulging a little bit. So 99% it's bad, and it's close to this slot, which makes me think that maybe that is actually the problem. So I'm going to replace it, but I don't want to need to take this whole thing apart, because as you can see, I should take everything out to take out the motherboard. What I plan to do is solder to the feet of that one capacitor. You can simply pull out on it, the feet will remain like that from the motherboard, and you solder another one and lay it down on its side and something like that. Yeah, I know it's not nice, but I don't want to open up this whole thing. It's just not worth it. And maybe that's not even the issue. Ripped out the capacitor. As you can see here, you just pull on it or bend it to the side until one of the feet comes out, then force the other one out. And it has 6.3 volts, 820 microfarads. I don't have a 100% identical replacement, but I have this one, which is exactly the same brand at 1000 microfarad, and it's close enough. And I just need to keep the polarity the right way. and hold it in here and solder it to the feet that are on, and this will not focus. Solder it to the feet that are still in the board. Really hard to show you what I need to do, but yeah, that's about it. And it's soldered, and yeah, I needed to remove this heat sink, it was in the way, so I will change its thermal paste, and this can be bent back into position. And yeah, that's how it will stay in there. Okay, let's see. Plugged in a cable that goes from HDMI to DVI. This thing only has VGA and DVI, it's a bit old. It's on. Doesn't this thing work? Okay. Was the seller a bit naughty and didn't say the truth, or this thing just doesn't have a proper power button at the moment? That might also be true. What? The power button, I cannot even press it by hand. Okay, now I pressed it. Voila! So I don't think the GPU is bad. It was that particular capacitor. And yeah, I need to plug these things in. And this thing seems to be working, which is awesome. I always wanted to see how, yeah, this boot failure anyway. How XP Media Center Edition 2005 looks like. I entered the BIOS before upgrading the CPU just to confirm that this is what we actually have. And it's a Pentium D 2.8 GHz. And this thing is really, 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 really quiet. I like that. And yeah, I like that the DVD, it's a Matsushita, I think. That's cool. And we have 3 gigs of RAM, which for XP, more than enough. So yeah, I could try to go to Windows 7, 10, but I'm not sure they have Media Center Edition and drivers for TV tuner and for everything inside this particular model. So it's better just to stick with what it was shipped with. So I have all the working drivers. And yes, for listening to music and watching full HD video and maybe TV, this thing is good enough. XP is doing what it needs to do. Already undid 2 screws here, lifted the cables up. And now this should come up something like this. Yes, it's catching a bit into the GPU, but not enough to prevent us from removing it. Or is it enough? It shouldn't be enough. It should not be enough to prevent us from removing this thing. Doesn't make sense. Yeah, it's not enough. It didn't make sense that they made it in such a way that you need to remove the GPU to upgrade the CPU. And yeah, quite a beefy little thing here. This is why this is so, so quiet. And as you can see, the GPU has an extension right here to take some fresh air and keep it cool. Yep, quite nicely done. And yeah, I didn't even show you. You just simply took my word for it that the GPU was bad. Let me show you in a moment. These are the specs of it from when I bought it. And yeah, GPU faulty. If I already opened up this thing, changed the thermal paste on the chipset, decided to also change it on the GPU, and as you can see from the 2 colors, somebody has taken care of this thing and did change the thermal paste at one point, and it was the same on this. It had white and this gray stuff. It didn't really clean it that well, but it doesn't really matter, at least they changed it. But this is a bit trickier. As you can see, you need to try and get it in here without knocking any of the components. Anyway, so let me do that off camera. I need to be really careful, and then I will show you how I put the CPU block back. Ta-da! The CPU is upgraded and a few new options appeared in here, which I think it's a good thing because this might be a bit newer, maybe a bit, few months or something like that. Anyway, everything is working, changed the thermal paste on everything in this system. Yeah, let's put Windows XP on this. Just wanted to show you fan speeds and temperatures in the BIOS before installing Windows, and also voltages. Everything is looking perfect in my opinion. Priority, first boot device, no, directly hard drive, second boot device, maybe here CD-ROM. And this removable, whatever. No cache. That's good. Yeah, I'm going to play around with it and make a bootable drive with Windows XP 2005 Media Center Edition. Started to install Windows XP from a USB drive because the optical drive in my main PC, it seems to not be working anymore. I haven't used it in a few years probably, and yeah, I need to open it up and see why it doesn't work anymore. So I cannot write a CD or DVD. Put Windows XP Multimedia Center on this thing. Obviously the one that I downloaded, it's in Italian, and I really hate it when people write everything in English and when you download the software it's in another language. Same with YouTube videos, they put English title, when you enter it it's in Indian, Russian, who knows what. I hate that. Anyway, luckily I do understand a few sentences in Italian, so I should be able to handle this. You know what? I'm going to do something completely different. Let's kill the power on this thing and put Windows 10 on it, because the drivers for XP are no longer available anywhere. Maybe if I would search for a few days on a weird Russian forum, I would find them somewhere. But Sony decided to remove all support for anything older. I think Windows 7 is the minimum they have driver for systems that do support officially Windows 7. So this one, zero drivers anywhere. So I will put Windows 10 and go from there, see what Windows 10 finds. Hopefully it finds enough for this thing to be usable. If not, oh well, it is what it is with all system like this. And I have microcode error when booting because I upgraded the CPU, so I need to try and upgrade the BIOS itself, which again probably will be really fun. If not, I will put back the old CPU. Yeah, anyway. So, installing Windows 10 Pro and working only from this little keyboard here, because it seems this does not work outside of an operating system, which is a bit annoying, but yeah, anyway. So, I'm going to old school style, using only this thing. So, let's see. Alt delete partition, yep, and now new partition, Alt E, and yeah, it will be fun. I said Alt E. Okay, let's go to new. Okay, I will create a 100 gig partition and the rest 220 gig. It will be secondary partition, and yeah, let's do this. And I'm installing 32-bit because this thing has 3 gigs of memory, so it will not benefit from 64-bit, and 64-bit moves slower on old machines like this. Well, at least up to this point it seems to be working. So let's do the initial setup and hope for the best, and then see how many of the drivers we are missing. Well, it's on, and now the pain begins, searching for drivers and whatnot. This thing still not working. Need to shut it off, power it on again, check that thing, plug it in, unplug it. Yeah, make sure the drivers are installed for this thing. Kind of lot of work to do, but needs to be done. The situation is not as bad as I thought. Only some drivers are missing. Network driver, probably Wi-Fi, I'm expecting it to be. Audio, obviously. Multimedia, probably TV tuner, and an unknown device. And for display, we are on basic display adapter. And the way mode system, I have no idea what that is. It's first time I see it. Seems to have a question mark next to it, so I will try to update the driver, or maybe after a restart it will disappear. But it's not as bad as I thought it would be. So, update driver. And I'm running on this thing, which is a Wi-Fi card for the moment, until we get the driver for the Wi-Fi inside of this. So, search automatically. And I will do the same for all of them. Come on, update driver, search automatically, and if I'm lucky, it will find some of them. If not, oh well, let's see, did it find something? Yeah, it didn't really find anything. So this might be a fun game of chasing drivers. Yep. Let's insist with all of them, maybe even one if it installs automatically, it helps us, but if not, no, well, not the first time I'm on this rodeo. Installing some software because I didn't want to use Edge to search for the drivers. I'm installing Chrome and a bunch of other things that I normally put on computers. Okay, let's get some drivers. First, display adapter, because it annoys me that everything moves so slowly. So go to properties, driver details, and hardware IDs. And this is what we need. 10 from vendor, 10DE, dev 0141. And that is what we are going to search on Google. So 10db0141. Was that the one? Or did I got it wrong? And obviously I cannot find the window. 0141, yeah, that's the one. So let's see what we actually have in here. I cannot find anything that good yet. Normally you, it was the first one, I didn't see it. So it's a GeForce 6600, Jesus, that was hard. So that's what driver I actually need. And this is not going to be easy. I'm going to search for Windows 10 driver. If I don't find it, I will go back to Windows 8 driver. Yeah, it's going to be a bit annoying, but I can, most times I find them, about 99% of time I find them like this. So let me do that. And if you think this system is slow, take a few things into consideration. Video driver not yet installed, so that might makes any system seem slow. We are running off a 320 old style hard drive. Yes, it's a 7200 RPM, but still slow. It's also doing, it's disabling indexing at the same time and installing software at the same time. So the fact that I still can use a browser decently, that's good enough in my book. Okay, and hopefully these drivers are good for what we need. If not, a bit more searching. Yep, somewhat to be expected. This thing, it actually says it supports only higher versions, so I don't even know why I tried. But I found a link from a forum for this old thing, which works up until Windows 8, and it does support 6 series GPUs. Where is the 6600? Here it is. And yeah, let's try with this version. This should work. Download now. Why is it grayed out? Hey, download now. Okay, I think I'm going to need to Google this, and probably Nvidia doesn't have this available anymore, because why would they? That would make things simple. Yeah, anyway, I will get it in the end for sure. I always do. And this version is working. Let me just show you which one. 309.08. Normally it's for Windows 8, 7, Vista, and it's 32-bit, exactly what we need. And another thing with units that load and unload the CD-DVD, it seems you can only use the big CDs. Those small ones, no. They will not work, they will get trapped in there. And the video driver is installed, as it always happens, although they say they don't have drivers for Windows 10, the ones from 7 and 8 actually work. So yeah, look here, no issues. Let's continue with audio, for example, same idea. Driver details and hardware IDs, and see what we can find for this thing. Function 01 in this case, vendor 8384, device 7661. Let's do some forum searching. And yeah, I will do exactly the same thing for all of them, and for that one that has this question mark, I will see if I can get rid of it. I need to search on forums and whatever. Voila, and we have audio driver, which is the same used for many Sony Vaio laptop series. So yeah, when people tell me they cannot find the drivers, you can find them. And yeah, I downloaded two stupid things that claimed to be drivers, but they were just installers for various other softwares that find drivers by themselves, and I just hate those things. When people say they cannot find drivers, they are just not searching good enough. If you search for vendor and model, it's impossible not to find it. Okay, now for the Wi-Fi driver. It was hard to find it initially directly by searching for this, but I realized by looking at the results, where is it? It's a Netgear WG311 V3. Then I searched simply for that, and first thing, Netgear website, we have the driver for Windows 7, which will work perfectly for us. So let's download that thing and install it. Okay, so this is the second day. I got tired yesterday, managed to install all drivers apart from this one, which is for the wireless card. And yes, I'm eating my words when I said that you can find drivers for everything for Windows 10. For this thing, you cannot find it. As you can see here, I tried a bunch of drivers. The newest version, I don't see it here, but it's one of these, and it's this one. It's 5.0.0.5. That is for Windows 7. Also, this one is for Windows 7, but people reported that this one was not even working on Windows 7. This was working on Windows 7 for some people, and for others, not even this one, unless they went into the BIOS and disabled, I don't know, serial ports, parallel ports, so they free up some IRQ channels. I don't have that option in the BIOS, so I cannot disable anything. There is some sort of conflict. Driver is installing without absolutely any errors, but I get this device cannot start. So, yeah, tried again a bunch of drivers, nothing actually worked. Could potentially try to update the BIOS first and hopefully then it would work, but that's not a sure thing. And then I remembered I have this thing, which is a Wi-Fi card from an old, was it a Fujitsu Siemens? I think it was a Fujitsu Siemens or Toshiba, no, Fujitsu Siemens laptop that I saved because it looked interesting, and I think it's a mini PCI slot. Not really sure. Anyway, seems to be exactly the same as the slot that we have in our PC. So unless it is somehow locked from the BIOS, I could potentially put this one in and I hopefully find a driver for it a bit easier, and I don't continue to get this error with this new card in. Hopefully. At least I'm going to try, because why not at this point? Okay, so I'm going to attempt to get the card out of there without removing everything around it. But I do need to remove the connector for the antenna. Yikes. That's not coming off easily, is it? And it's out. So it seems to have latches exactly like laptop memory would have. That should make it fairly easy to remove. I could actually get my hands in there. So, I did this latch, but the other one is really stubborn. And I think not the latch itself, but the fact that I genuinely don't have access in there. Okay, yeah, I need both hands, and anyway, I cannot really film in there, so. Be back in a second. And they do seem to look the same. Yeah, I hope they don't have different pinouts or something. Anyway, I'm going to try it because, again, why not? I could potentially remove. No, I'm going to leave this sticker in here. It has some kind of protection sticker all over it. So the connector, the antenna is not plugged into the wrong socket, but I know to plug it into the main one. Hope for the best. And it's in, and we are booting up. So hopefully it works. But that antenna connector right there was a pain to insert. Guess what? Windows 10 installed the driver automatically for this thing. So it's not Windows 10 issue. It's crappy drivers from crappy manufacturers issue. These two cards are about the same age. This one is working perfectly in Windows 10, installing drivers by itself. The other one barely work in Windows 7 and not working in Windows 10. So yeah, let me just zoom out for a moment. Let me see if I can do that. And sorry, but I will move you. Still not zoomed out to the max. Tripod squeaking, whatever. And let me unplug this thing and see if we will get a Wi-Fi connection on the other thing. And yes, it sees the networks. So the card inside works perfectly, and the antenna that I put on it also works. So let me connect to my Wi-Fi. I've run into a different problem. I cannot use this thing. I get approximately the same error that I got with the Wi-Fi. So this thing is really limited. And in my computer, for example, this works perfectly. Just tested it. So let me try and update the BIOS and see what I get. Search for this thing right here. Somebody has gone to the trouble of updating the BIOS for these things, although Sony didn't. So you can actually update or upgrade your CPU, which is awesome. And yeah, I need to update the BIOS. Read all of these things. I'm not going to make a different video or something like that just for this. Google it. I will try to put this link in the description so we can reach this page. And this really tells you how to do it. Yeah, I'm going to do it now and hope for the best. Maybe I can get this thing working. If not, I'm not going to use it. Just plug in a standard keyboard and that's it. What's up with optical drives these days? This thing also cannot read disks, so I need to open it up and clean it. Probably just because nobody uses them anymore. It's like in the old days when we switched from floppy to optical, floppies would just not read and you would need to clean them and pray to them and whatnot. And this thing that I left about, I think it was on the front of this and somebody put it here, so it's not Sony's fault. Anyway. So it's not even ejecting, I can only eject from Windows, but. Yeah, not reading it for sure. So I need to open it up once again to update the BIOS. Opened up this thing. Even more, it was at the point opened up, oiled everything, cleaned that, but not sure if this will ever work. On bigger models, on desktop models, I know you can adjust the power of the laser itself when the unit gets old and stops reading. On this one, I didn't find the adjustments, so. I don't know. I did my best. If it works, okay. If not, that's about it. So let's put this thing back together. And as you can see, it has a bunch of levers that do various things when you insert the disk in it. So yeah, quite complicated compared to a standard laptop unit. Even this thing lifts up like it does in a desktop unit, and it doesn't in a laptop unit. So this is, for its size, it's quite complicated. Nice, but complicated. Okay, so not having an optical drive to work with, I'm going to burn this thing, the optical drive, the disk image, onto a USB drive using Rufus. So yeah, in the end, I do exactly the same thing. Don't check for updates, but I'm using USB drive. Yeah, so this ISO, ISO image, this one, either non-bootable or it uses boot compression that is not supported by Rufus. Oh God, really? Jesus. Yeah, I need to find another way to write it. I'm going to try something else. So, this thing, again, I will try it. Same error. Then I'm going to use FreeDOS, so it will just make this USB drive bootable. Start. All data will be destroyed. Yeah, I have nothing on that USB drive. And while it is doing that, I'm actually going to take this image and mount it and see what we have on it. And we have a lot, which is quite annoying. Let's see. Control C, and when this thing finishes, ready. Okay. I'm going to go here and Control V, and hopefully I can use it like this. So it is bootable, but I'm not sure if the software is made in this version of MS-DOS that's used for FreeDOS. I will try. Not giving up, so I'm going to attempt to use Yummy to burn this thing onto a USB drive. Let me at least plug in the USB drive first, because it didn't work with what I put on it. It doesn't care, it sees them, but I don't get the menu, and without the menu, I'm not really sure what I should write and how. So, yeah, long story short, I don't know. Okay, this one. Okay. But wiping entire disk 5, it's better like that. The problem is that I don't know what I'm actually writing here. What is this thing based on? Is it based on MS-DOS? In theory, yes, the executable files look like they come from MS-DOS, but so XP installer, no. Unlisted ISO, no. I need to find some MS-DOS, FreeDOS. I think it's here, but it's not FreeDOS. Kinda hate this. Be back in a moment. Okay, so I went with unlisted ISO grub partition 4. I think this is what I used in the past for unknown things. Create fourth partition table. Yikes, no. I think I will go with the version that doesn't say anything about the fourth partition table. Format it, wipe entire disk, yeah. Jeez. Okay, this one. And this one. Okay, create. Yes, you will delete it, I know that. A working optical drive would have been much easier. What? Access is denied. What are you talking about? Jesus, I'm really curious if this will actually work in the end. I think it worked. And it needs to write the files and blah 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 blah. What? Why are you opening up all of these things? It's copying files to my drive, but I have no idea why it opened them up anyway. This PC is fighting me all the way, and I need to buy a Windows 10 license for about $1 or $2 from eBay, because I don't have a license on it. All finished. No more distros. All is good. Hopefully, let's see what we can see here. Yeah, standard files and our ISO here. I don't know. I don't really know. I'm going to attempt to boot from this thing and see what we get. Okay, finally it actually did work. So I want the modified BIOS for the XL100. This is mine. Advanced edition. XL100 again. Loading some sort of driver. Completely at my own risk. Please ensure this is the correct selection. Yes, it is. Understand the above. You cannot see it. Let me move the camera and it will squeak. Sorry about that. Enter the choice. Yes. Really? Oh no. Oh no. No, God, no. It's trying to read it from the DVD drive. Ah, Jesus. I need to connect the DVD drive to this thing, the one from my computer, for example, after I repair it, obviously. Yeah, it's not going to work. Jesus. No. Yeah, this is when you are dealing with custom stuff that wasn't made to be able to handle all these modifications. Remembered something else. I have this unit from a laptop, which is a DVD writer, but it's standard laptop unit on IDE, because this thing is on IDE. But it's not slow loading, it's front loading standard. And what I think I'm going to do, I know many of you will not like this, but this is an old system. This thing is too expensive, just not worth it. I'm going to see how much I need to cut from this thing so this fits in. Sorry guys, but what needs to be done, needs to be done. But first, obviously, I will make sure this actually works and I will update the BIOS and then do the cutting. Yes, and this thing is actually working. So again, simpler technology seems to be holding up way better over time. Also, another weird thing, the eject button was not actually working on the other drive. Let me see, does it work on this one? Because it's electronic, so there are two wires that go to the motherboard, so even that is electronically controlled on this particular PC. No, not working. So probably it needs some drivers to be installed, so this thing is really driver dependent. I'm expecting many of these things, of the ports, outputs, inputs, not to work without the proper old XP drivers, but so we have Windows 10, but we lose a lot of the features, but we don't have drivers for Windows XP for this thing anymore, so yeah. And it's working from this drive, which will be going in. Writing the BIOS, press yes and hope for the best. Don't turn off power or reset system. If we get a power failure at this moment, it's bye-bye. So yeah, hopefully we will... I think the original BIOS was from 2001. Yeah, something like that I've seen. So, yikes. This thing seems to be obviously newer. Flashing complete. Remove diskette and hit F1 to continue. Yeah. Remove optical drive in our case. It's removed. F1 and be back. And this thing is working, and I'm powering on once again just so you can see the new art that the person that modified these BIOSes implemented or inserted, Mr. Big. Anyway, oh, I forgot to press F2 to enter the BIOS itself. Damn it, Windows will load, shutting it off. Be back when I'm in the BIOS. Okay, so it didn't change any settings in here. BIOS version is still 2001, but I think the date actually changed, so yeah, there's that. We have a SATA mode IDE and we can set it to what we need, but remains to IDE because this is how we actually installed Windows, otherwise it will not power on. Okay, enhanced auto, yeah, good. And yeah, we don't get that error anymore. So that is actually perfect. I'm just checking to see if anything new popped up in here, but I don't think it did. Priority, let's put hard drive first, because I don't want it to search for a CD every single time. Second, removable, and third, CD. Okay, it's saved. Boot settings. Nothing interesting, security, nothing. Yeah, okay, so let me just let it boot for you and you will see that we don't get the CPU microcode error anymore, so the CPU upgrade is finally completed. And now I need to cut this case somehow. Yeah, Jesus. Okay, so we would have gotten the error by now when I would have needed to press F1, but no need, so it's perfect. Okay, so the optical unit fits exactly like the original one. Put one screw there, need to put a second one here. All the small screws on the side that hold it in place are in there. It fits perfectly in the cutout in here. Just need to do a cutout in that. And yeah, let's put this everything back together. And you can see when I'm really fed up with a computer, I don't even turn it off when I'm not working on electrical stuff. So if it dies, it's its choice, not mine. Ready to do some cutting. I'm fairly sure where left and right edges will be, but and upper edge, but lower edge remains to be seen. This is what I will use to cut. I could use a Dremel, but yeah, from my experience with Dremels, I cannot really cut straight with them. I have a bigger chance with this, if you can believe me. So anyway, let's get to it. I will cut the hole a bit smaller and then use file to make it larger, and again, hope for the best. I've cut the upper part and the edges, and I've measured how much I need to cut to fit this thing in. And honestly, it's about this whole thing. So I'm going to basically cut everything that you see here in black almost, and go from there. I've cut the thing off, peeled it off actually, it's double-sided tape, just the edges. And now I will attempt to go right up until the edge, but not beyond it. I'm not really sure I can explain, but you will see. My idea is beginning to show up, and I think it's going quite well. So let's bring out a file and optimize this shape. It's cut, but I don't really like how it looks. I want to bring the optical drive flush with this, so I need to do some modifications and see what we get. Finishing off the edges with a bit of this thing. So that is one where I've put this. Focus. Looking quite nice. And here is one where I don't have that yet. So yeah. When you cut plexic or plastic, put a coat of this thing on your cut and it will look much nicer. And yeah, it's nail polish. And to hold this thing in place, I've put the caddy back with its screws, and I will use this double-sided tape. And please believe me, this will hold way more than it needs to. I've put SSDs with less than half of this thing, and I barely was able to get them out. For sure, this would bend before that would release. So, yeah. Obviously, because I moved everything forward, the adapter needed to be unscrewed from its place and plugged directly into the optical drive, but that doesn't matter at all. Let me lock this connector in place. If I could actually do it with one hand, I cannot do it with one hand. If you are wondering how I took this out, you simply pull on it from one end slowly, and this will, I don't know, spread a little bit and come out. Now I need to do that in reverse, make sure this one goes in properly because, as you can see, it's not completely round, but yeah, you simply push it back in place. So, let me show you what I did here. Working perfectly. Yeah, there's a bit of a gap here and here. Top is perfect. On the bottom, again, looks quite nice. But, yeah. DIY. And we have a working DVD writer, which we obviously didn't have before. And we have also bought a copy of Windows 10. So this is activated now. Let's see again. Oh, come on, system. Windows is activated, which is awesome. This thing working, doing its job. So we have a DVD writer in this thing. All drivers installed. Yeah, I cannot use that particular keyboard, but we have Wi-Fi. Yeah, for what it is, it's usable. It's still working. If you have one, yeah, you can go to Windows 10. You will have problems with drivers, might lose a lot of the functionality, but if you don't have any other choice, maybe a version of Linux would be better, some multimedia version, but I'm not sure how well it will handle the weird hardware inside this thing, which is a combination between desktop and laptop parts and yeah, weird. But if you are thinking of buying one of these older models, I'm not sure if they are making new ones now, but the older ones, ooh, stay away. Stay away for sure. So yeah, that's been it for this particular video. Quite long, with lots of ups and downs, but in the end managed to make a working computer out of it. Half decent. And yeah, that's about it. If you have any questions, feel free to ask in the comments. Check out my other videos, subscribe, and as always, see you in the next one. Bye.